Today we are talking about a doozy of a case, Carpenter versus United States. Now, generally I think it's sweet when someone cares enough about me to want to know where I am, but not when it's the federal government. Now, there was a lot at stake with this case that was argued on November 29th, 2017, and like most of these cases, a decision is yet to be released. Basically,
types of location records, information about the state of the body, like heart rate data from a smartwatch, or fertility tracking data from a smartphone app, information about the interior of a home, for example, from a smart thermostat that knows when the homeowner is at home and perhaps what room they're in, communicative contents, not only the contents of emails, but I think search queries to Google. Not every record will or should be protected, and I think it is totally consistent with the role of the lower courts to take an interpretive principle from this court and begin to apply it, and over time, clarity will emerge.
Oh, geez. Yeah, this is the big one. So buckle up your tinfoil hats and set fire to your electronics, because this is the case that will define modern digital privacy for American citizens. Also, come on, we'll work it out in the lower courts? We're talking about my search history here, man. I need answers. So, as always, let's get a little background on this case, which sees its origins lying in the most unlikely of stories. Timothy Carpenter and a few of his friends started robbing Circuit Cities and T-Mobiles. People became suspicious when they saw a customer entering into Circuit City or T-Mobile stores. Anyways, they would break in brandishing weapons and demand that the employees give them all of the latest smartphones. And in a dark ironic twist, smartphones were the very thing that brought them down. Because after four of Timothy's co-conspirators were brought down, the government was given his phone number, and without a warrant, were able to track his cell phone locations every moment for the past 127 days, and found that he was at the scene of all of the robberies. He was quickly tracked down and arrested, which led him to sue, leading to where we are today.
The Supreme Court is going to be considering whether the history of cell phone locations stored by a phone service provider is searchable without a warrant.
Now, I could only find two news sources actually discussing this case. One was Fox News, and the other was our friendly neighborhood Russian propagandists over at RT. Because that was the same day NBC fired Matt Lauer, so clearly we couldn't handle both the firing and the future of our privacy falling under government surveillance all in one day. Seriously though, if you think people should know about this before a decision comes out, share this video. With that, let's dive right into this case.
You'll hear argument this morning in case 16-402, Carpenter versus United States.
Alright, so one of the first things that should stand out to me when I was listening to this case is that this wasn't the first time government tracking of cell phones has been used as evidence.
We identify in our reply brief one case where the government obtained 454 days of historical location data for one defendant, 388 for another. We have 127 days here, 221 days in Graham from the Fourth Circuit with a cert petition currently pending. That is a quite extraordinary amount of time.
Now, I know, some cynics out there might be thinking, well, I knew the government was watching my every step. But, according to this case, statistically speaking, most people don't know that it's happening. And, oddly enough, that's one of the major arguments against it happening.
In the empirical scholar's amicus brief at pages 3 through 4, they run through a result of a survey that I think quite strongly shows that a strong majority of Americans do not understand that this information is even accessible to, much less retained by, the service providers.
Now, this argument led to the stand-up comedian Justice Kennedy doing a classic bit.
When you talk about normal expectations and we have to make the judgment, it seems to me there's a much more normal expectation that businesses have your cell phone data. I think everybody, almost everybody knows that. If I know it, everybody does. But I don't think there's an expectation that people are following you for 127 days.
I'm laughing so hard I'm crying. Interestingly enough, this was an argument that the Supreme Court kept coming back to. If there isn't an expectation of government surveillance in certain ways, then can the government surveil you in those ways? It almost makes me want to shut the heck up and tell you to forget everything you just heard. Now, to understand why expectation plays such a key part in surveillance morality, we have to look at...
At issue in this case is the government's warrantless collection of 127 days petitioner's cell site location information, revealing his locations, movements, and associations over a long period. As in Jones, the collection of this information is a search, as it disturbs people's longstanding practical expectation that their longer-term movements in public and private spaces will remain private.
In 2012, a criminal case against Antoine Jones went to the Supreme Court after it was found that the FBI had attached a GPS tracker to his car and tracked him for 4 weeks without getting the proper warrants. So, next time someone asks you if you want to add GPS services to your new car, make sure they're working for the dealership and not the government. Anyways, this was ruled to be a search by the Supreme Court, meaning that because they didn't have a warrant, it violated his Fourth Amendment rights, which we'll talk about more in a bit, as it is pretty crucial to this case. Anyways, the important point here is, and I don't mean to sound like Bill Clinton,
it depends upon what the meaning of the word is.
Yes. Come on, Bill. That is literally the first word they teach you in any language. In this case, though, it depends on what the word search means. In the past, it has referred to going through physical documents. But more recently, in a legal sense, search was expanded to be applied to an expectation of privacy as well. It has now been asserted that something becomes a search when the government violates someone's reasonable expectation of privacy. And to do a search, you need a warrant. This is where things really start to get confusing, because you need to be more of an English teacher than a legal scholar to properly explain this. I mean, what is a reasonable expectation of privacy? Well, the more Supreme Court cases you listen to, the more you realize that the government really doesn't have a basic definition for ultra-important building blocks to our society. Things in your house and hotel rooms and public bathrooms are protected. But once you get outside, it might not be protected. For example, if someone's rifling through your trash, it could either be a raccoon or a government agent. One of the questions that got raised was whether your location, because it is public by nature, you know, you're walking around getting seen by people, can that be protected by a reasonable expectation of privacy? Now, there was a very interesting rebuttal to this point.
Well, I mean, that's a debatable empirical point, whether people realize what's going on, and there's reason to think maybe they do. I mean, people know there were all these commercials, can you hear me now? Our company has lots of towers everywhere. What do they think that's about?
What? Seriously? How can you argue that? The guy was saying, can you hear me now, not can you track me now? Yeah, companies say they have a lot of cell phone towers in their commercials. What do people think that's about? I don't know, maybe getting good service? Although T-Mobile claims to have the most towers of any carrier, and their service is garbage, so maybe they're using them for an ulterior motive. Anyways, he went on.
The contract, the standard Metro PCS contract, seems to say, and I guess we don't have the actual contract in the record here, does seem to say that advise the customer that we can disclose this information to the government if we get a court order.
You know, it's weird, but every time they brought up contracts, it was always a Metro PCS contract, as if Metro PCS had organized the worst endorsement deal of all times. The following surveillance program is brought to you by Metro PCS. It was brought up several times that in our phone contracts, we acknowledge that cell phone companies can turn over our location details if the government requests them. But this brought up a second question. Is your location data your property? Which would make this quite literally a search and seizure.
The property-based approach to privacy also has to be considered, not just the reasonable expectation approach. If someone were to steal my location information from T-Mobile, I'd have a conversion claim, for example, against them for the economic value that was stolen. Wouldn't that therefore be a search of my paper?
Now, this conversation was never fully discussed, although it was shot down pretty hard a few seconds later when Justice Alito said,
I was trying to think of an example of a situation in which a person would have a property right in information that the person doesn't ask a third party to create, the person can't force the third party to create it or to gather it, the person can't prevent the company from gathering it, the person can't force the company to destroy it, the person can't prevent the company from destroying it, and according to petitioner, the customer doesn't even have a right to get the information.
This conflict is yet to be resolved, so it'll be interesting to see if it plays a part in their decision. But this brings us to a huge point that was discussed almost more than phones in this case, and that is...
Miller involved more limited records. Certainly they could reveal some sensitive information, but more limited records, and as this court held, they were voluntarily conveyed, and that they were created by the passing of negotiable instruments into the stream of commerce to transfer funds. What we have here is both more sensitive and less voluntary.
It's hard to believe that a case about bootlegging from 1973, a time when cell phones were bigger than an SUV, could be critical to our digital privacy. But tis the world we live in. So what happened in United States versus Miller? Well, there was a bootlegger who, apparently not realizing that alcohol had been legalized decades ago, was continuing to illegally operate his own brewery. At this time, he was using a bank, as one does, and the Bank Secrecy Act of 1970 had just passed, which really helped resolve the problem of banks being too transparent. This act required that banks keep years of financial records for legal compliance, which the government took and used as evidence without a warrant against Miller. In this case, the bank voluntarily handed over this financial information, and it was seen by the court as not a violation of the expectation of privacy. Now, this case requires defining a word that I think most people in today's climate might not be too comfortable talking about.
So what does consent mean to you?
Oh geez, I have to define consent to understand this case? Alright, well let's just dive right in then. In this case, the Supreme Court said that, by performing a financial transaction using a bank, the defendant was consenting to the bank keeping a record of the transaction, and therefore the record was the bank's. Dissenting opinions said that the transaction happened between two consenting adults, while the bank was only the mechanism by which the transactions were made. This does have a pretty clear allegory to the internet, where I'm using Comcast to research this, and therefore Comcast is my entire search history, which is why it's better to do things offline now. So this brings us to the next obvious question.
Why? Is cell site location information more sensitive than bank records, which particularly today, when a lot of people don't use cash much, if at all, a bank record will disclose purchases. It will not only disclose everything that the person buys, it will not only disclose locations, but it will disclose things that can be very sensitive.
Good point. Wait, is he arguing that we don't need a warrant to track people by their cell phone, or why we should need a warrant to view someone's financials? Never a great argument to say you can't be violating someone's rights by doing this when we're really violating people's rights by tracking their bank records. This triggered quite the debate, though, with the plaintiff's lawyer arguing.
Information in bank records can be quite sensitive, but what it cannot do is chart a minute-by-minute account of a person's locations and movements and associations over a long period, regardless of what the person is doing at any given moment.
Now, this is an interesting point that we will get to more in a second, but this argument that came in different forms down the line is essentially that monitoring your every movement is bad, but just kind of checking up on you at specific times or looking at your specific records is acceptable. That said, some people took this argument even further, saying...
Information in the bank records that Justice Alito referred to are not publicly known. Your whereabouts are publicly known. People can see you. Surveillance officers can follow you. It seems to me that this is much less private.
Is it just me, or does the federal government kind of sound more and more like a stalker just trying to justify themselves? Hey, I already took their bank records. Why not just follow them around? It's a free country. I can do that. Anyways, going back to earlier, in the plaintiff's words, here is why you can't.
When a person is engaged in a financial transaction, passing a check, a negotiable instrument, that's an interpersonal transaction where a person has full knowledge that they are putting something into the stream of commerce to transfer funds directed at their bank. As the five concurring justices made clear in Jones, although we may, when we step outside, have a reasonable expectation that someone may see where we go on a short period, nobody has expected in a free society that our longer-term locations will be aggregated and tracked in the way that they can be here.
To reiterate a point from earlier, in this case, ignorance is power, because this may be one of the few times where, if you don't believe in something, it isn't true. This leads us to the clear question of, well, why can't the government just tail someone for 127 days? Well, that would be legal, but the sticking point is...
Here, it's even a step more removed. Here, never could police have decided today to track me 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, 5 months ago. That is a categorically new power that is made possible by these perfect tracking devices that 95% of Americans carry in their pockets.
This case isn't about limiting investigators from getting access to someone's phone records. Just get a warrant like you would do for someone's house, because...
The probable cause and particularity requirements of a warrant will do a lot of work to focus investigations. In an investigation like this, perhaps 127 days or 152, as the original request was, would not all be appropriate. Maybe under a warrant, a 2 or 3 day span around each of the robberies would actually be particularly relevant to the probable cause determination.
I mean, if you're tracking someone and you're not sure why, then you, sir, need a hobby and some friends ASAP. So this led us to the defendant, the federal prosecutor, who had spied on the criminal's testimony, where he brought up a point that I found so interesting, I actually highlighted it in my notes.
The cell phone companies in this case function essentially as witnesses, being asked to produce business records of their own transactions with customers.
What can I say? In the previous episode, we established that corporations are people, so they can be witnesses too. Sure, why not? Getting a company to snitch isn't very hard. It's basically just a digital testimony. I just hope that T-Mobile's customer care guarantee includes not turning state's evidence. Even further, in a case this clip references that I won't go into on detail, Katz versus the United States, the Supreme Court decided it was illegal for the FBI to listen to the content of calls.
We're dealing here with routing information. We're not dealing with the contents of communications. I agree with you that Katz makes clear that incidental access of a provider to the contents of a communication when the provider is functioning as an intermediary doesn't vitiate Fourth Amendment protection.
Yes, it's not seeing their content. It's just seeing where people are at all times without their knowledge or consent. Phew, I was worried this might lead to overstepping for a second. Although it was pointed out that legally speaking, after the case of Riley v. California, cell phones are considered a requirement in our daily life, which means you aren't really voluntarily opting into a tracking program as much as required to enter it. Because if 5 minutes go by and I don't have my phone with me, I instantly hit all 5 stages of depression. Or, as Urban Dictionary would put it, selancholy. I mean, what am I gonna do? Start using 2 cans attached by a string? Or a walkie-talkie? So this brings us to the overarching question of the case.
John Adams said one of the reasons for the war was the use by the government of third parties to obtain information, force them to help as their snitches and snoops. Why isn't this argument exactly what the framers were concerned about? And you can subpoena anything that any company has anywhere in the globe, regardless of any property rights, regardless of any privacy interests, simply because it's a third party.
Is this going against every fundamental of the Constitution? Something I've heard the Supreme Court is supposed to avoid. By being able to obtain data from third parties like apps and service providers without obtaining a warrant, is the government overstepping reasonable expectations of privacy? Now, I can't tell you, although next time you commit a crime, I would definitely recommend you keep your phone at home. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hello YouTube, I hope you enjoyed that last video. For more episodes of Supreme Court Saturday, click here. Please like and subscribe by clicking here. And if you're really a fan, you can join our Facebook group. It's just a party over there.